これが最後の月牙天章だ。
The climactic battle between Ichigo and Aizen was one of Bleach's most gut-wrenching and thrilling fights, concluding the Aranka arc and sending off one of the series' most powerful villains, Sosuke Aizen. It included one of the most satisfying moments in the Bleach series, the final Getsuga Tensho, followed up by Aizen's not-so-satisfying moment of basically just standing up and brushing it off, not realising how much damage it truly did to him. The Mugetsu technique allowed the seal which Kisuke Urahara placed inside of Aizen to activate, sealing him away and allowing him to be imprisoned. This, however, could only leave us pondering the question, what if? You see, the final Getsuga Tensho is, well, final, right? Meaning that once used, that's it. So bearing this in mind, what if Ichigo missed? Well, he would just lose the fight entirely, of course. Sure, but what does that imply? And that is the question we'll be discussing in this episode of Bleach. What if? So straight away, we can assume that Aizen was perfectly capable of moving out of the way, and that's what he did, rather than assuming that Ichigo's hand just casually slipped. I'm sure Aizen would spout some long speech about how he's the best and you are the worst in his own philosophical way. However, would Aizen actually kill Ichigo? At the end of the battle, we find out that Aizen actually wanted an equal, someone to fight so he wouldn't feel lonely. As Ichigo himself stated, he sensed loneliness in his sword. Despite this, it would mean that the seal that Kisuke placed on Aizen would never actually activate, making it super awkward when Kisuke would actually arrive later on the battlefield. Considering Mr. Hattonclog's hefty arsenal of weaponry and tricks, it's hard to actually say exactly what would happen next. But to be frank, it doesn't really matter. Kisuke himself outright said his Bankai wasn't meant to be used within combat, which we also see later in the Thousand Year Blood War arc, so it most likely wouldn't have a significant impact on Aizen. Are there other Kido and seals that Kisuke could use? Of course, but at the end of the day, Aizen's constant state of evolution would make sure that they are all futile. At this point, Kisuke only has two options, lose the fight or run away. However, no matter which option he chooses, Aizen will still perfectly be capable of completing his goal. Aizen's main goal was to use the spirits of Karakura Town along with the town itself to create the Oken, granting him a passage to the Soul King's palace. How long would it take Aizen to do this? It's actually unclear, as Aizen himself has never really stated how long it would actually take him. However, considering the speed at which Shinigami relocated the entire Karakura Town into the Soul Society, it'd be reasonable to assume that Aizen could get started pretty much within the hour of him arriving at his destination. I only bring this up because it means that the rest of the captains, such as Kenpachi, Unohana, Mayuri and Byakuya, along with Ichigo's friends, won't actually be able to make it out of Hueco Mundo in time to actually prevent Aizen from doing so. And unless Kurumadani Sanosuke or Don Kanoji can put up one hell of a fight, yeah, I think it's over. Now, considering the current mental state of which Aizen is in, it would be out of the question to suggest that it would even wait even more than a second before barging into the Soul Palace. But here comes the real question. Is Aizen prepared to face and defeat all five of Squad Zero? Squad Zero are also known as the Royal Guard. They are put in place by the Soul King specifically for his protection. Aizen's goal is ultimately to either absorb the Soul King's powers or just outright kill him. As he does shout to Kisuke, "How could you subject yourself to that thing?" And as well, a victor should speak out the world as it should be, not how it is, suggesting that he either wants to topple the keystone that controls the world, or he wants to be the one that rules it and be the one to create the rules. Either way, defeating Squad Zero is no easy task. In the Thousand Year Blood War, Uetsu Namaya, also known as the number one Zanpakuto creator,
"I am now for one Zanpakuto creator,"
one shot four of the elite squad that Yuha brought with him to the Soul Palace. Even with Aizen's supposed immortality, there's nothing to say a quick and easy decapitation by Nimaya wouldn't finish him off, or being crushed into a ball by the clothes of Sitara, or even being completely rewritten by Ichibei. He could simply write the kanji for Sakura and reduce Aizen to a babbling idiot who couldn't do anything. That's all assuming, of course, that Squad Zero aren't in fact affected enough by Kyoka Sugetsu, of course, Aizen's his most powerful tool being the complete hypnosis. If Aizen manages to activate this Shikai, Squad Zero might just be swinging into the air for the entirety of the fight, while Aizen calmly walks through them and gets into the Soul King's room. Even if Squad Zero aren't affected by his Shikai, it would be a good idea for them to assume that Aizen does in fact have a Bankai as well, especially since you would naturally assume that someone on Aizen's level of intellect and curiosity would achieve such a Bankai in the first place, just to know what it felt like and what it was. For this theory, however, let's just assume that Aizen uses a lot of his energy to fight them, goes Bankai, and that's what wins him the fight, since that does in fact sound badass. And also because if we were to assume that Squad Zero does win the fight, pretty much everything that we know in the story would play out pretty much the same way. Standing at the very center of the room, Aizen stares into the eyes of the Soul King. This is the moment he's been waiting for his entire life. Now Aizen realizes he has a choice to make, either just kill the Soul King and collapse everything, or take the power and make the universe his own. While this is all speculation, it would probably be wise to assume Aizen takes the power of the Soul King. I mean, come on, we know Aizen, of course, he would do that. He would probably spout some philosophical nonsense to convince himself that it was the logical outcome, when really, he just wanted to because he was curious and thought that it would make him the biggest badass in the universe, to which it probably would. Of course, as Aizen impales the Soul King, earthquakes would start all around the whole world again, just like it did when Yuhai did it in the Thousand Year Blood War. The only difference is that the most important character, Jishiro Ukitake, wouldn't be conscious to summon the Mimihagi, allowing the Soul King to stay intact. Because, you know, Wonder Voice. With Aizen successfully on the throne, he could continue to carry out his secondary goal, exposing the sins of the Soul Society. Aizen had been planning this for hundreds of years, dating all the way back to Turn Back the Pendulum with Kisuke Urahara and the original holification experiments. This would imply that he found out about the Soul King early on within his research, and about how it came into being. So now was his chance to expose the wrongdoings of the Serote to the rest of the Soul Society. Upon returning back to the Soul Society, he would now be greeted with the rest of the captain forces from the Gotei, who he had already cut down already. After Kisuke Urahara ran away from the battlefield, he would probably have re-established a path from Hwaikamundo to the Soul Society, allowing people like Orihime, himself and Unohana to quickly patch up the defeated captains, getting them back up to be able to fight with a considerate amount of strength. Maybe not full strength, but a considerate amount of strength. Now comes the second most important part in this timeline. Could Aizen once again defeat all of those captains, even with the powers of the Soul King? Don't forget, we still do have Yamamoto's Bankai, along with Shunsui's and Jushiro's, Unohana's, and theoretically even Chojuro's. It's worth mentioning that right now, this is all hypothetical, and it's very difficult to pin all those characters against each other. So, unless Kubo Sensei says otherwise, I say yes. Aizen can defeat them all. Remember, Aizen may very well still have a Bankai, and we have no idea what it is, so it could easily be a deciding factor. Assuming Aizen gets rid of the rest of the Gotei, Aizen will most likely either make his own throne in the Soul Society and control it himself, as we know he actually likes the Soul Society, or just go sit back up in the Soul Palace and control it from there. Either way, this is all going according to his plan. 2 years pass with Aizen controlling the Soul Society, and now we have the official canon introduction of the Fullbringers, and most importantly, Ruruka. Now, the Fullbringers are an interesting wildcard as they each have a piece of the Soul King inside of them, so would Aizen even be aware of their existence now, or would he not care? Either way, it is now time to focus on Ichigo's side of the story. Assuming that Ichigo survived the incineration of Karakura Town, it would be very safe to assume that Yuzu and Karin did not. Whether Kisuke saved Ichigo's dad and Yodowichi up until this point would be also unknown. Depressed out of his mind, Ichigo would most likely be actively seeking or searching for a way to restore his Shinigami powers, even after just losing them. This would most likely lead him to the Fullbringers way earlier on in the story than he originally found them. The only difference now is that the story has gone a completely different path. For all Ginjo knows, the Soul Society is dead, and so are the captains, so he really has no one to be mad at anymore, and would in fact maybe even side more with Aizen than he would with Ichigo. But for the sake of the story, let's just say that Ichigo finds a way to convince Ginjo to give him his Fullbringer powers, and fully master them as Ichigo does, as Ichigo too has a piece of the Soul King inside of him. As Ichigo trains and gets his Fullbring to mastery, 2 years have gone by. Yuhai is now ready to begin his invasion with the Vandana Lake onto the Soul Society, but Yuhai isn't the type of guy to just barge into the Soul Society without a plan, as now Ichigo is actively also trying to fight against the Soul Society. Yuhai's best plan at this chance is to seek out Ichigo and explain to him about his Quincy powers and lineage, telling him about his mother. Ichigo in this case would probably see Yuhai as the best chance he has to defeat Aizen, so he would most likely take up being a member of the Sternritters after being taught how to use his Quincy powers by Yuhai. So he would most likely take up being a member of the Sternritters after being taught how to use his Quincy powers by Yuhai, unlocking his full potential. My theory from what this may look like is New Year's Quincy Ichigo from Bleach Brave Souls, or you can just go with what Ichigo looks like within the current Thousand Year Blood War arc. It's up to you. But of course, tell me in the comment section down below of what you think the script that Yuha would probably give Ichigo, because that sounds like an interesting one. Now comes the final fight, the Quincy's versus the very small amounts of Soreepers that may or may not exist. For example, Renji, Rukia, and even someone like Hinataro would maybe survive. Versus the man himself, Aizen, and the Arrancar. Assuming that he kept the Arrancar and they were still, you know, loyal. I imagine Yuha would have some major copium by seeing Aizen literally walking up and taking the powers he wanted after waiting 1,000 years in the first place. Now, there are two ways I can see this fight going. One way is that Yuha's Sturmritters, including Ichigo, far outpower Aizen and his army, taking back control of the Soul Society and allowing Yuha to be a god, changing the whole universe and reality as he deems fit. I wouldn't imagine Ichigo would have an issue with this since most of his family are dead at this point, so he would most likely feel defeated in that sense already. The alternative, of course, is that Aizen has continued to evolve to such an imaginable level that it is basically impossible to stop him at this point. He could basically Thanos snap the Sturmritter army completely out of existence and continue drinking his tea like nothing happened, whilst maybe having a scuffle with Yuha in the meantime, rearranging the universe only slightly. Ichigo losing the fight would of course leave him most likely dead, as Aizen wouldn't even waste his time waiting for Ichigo to try and transcend to his powers of a god just so he can fight him again in the future. So, what is the conclusion of all this? At the end of the day, Ichigo missing Mugetsu makes the future look, well, bleak. It's either Aizen or Yuha on the throne and they completely dominate, with not an ounce of remorse or consideration. Could the likes of artifacts like Shinken Hakyoken beat them in the future? Could Shuhei Hisage's Bankai help win? What about Hikone and Tokinada? Could they come in to save the day? Possibly, maybe, but there's way too much to even consider when actually trying to predict the future. Because realistically, very small variables, even things like whether Ganju is or isn't there, could decide on the outcome of an event. There's a lot of things I didn't talk about. So if you have any suggestions on things you want me to talk about in the future, leave them down in the comment section down below and tell me what you think will actually happen in this scenario. And of course, give me any further suggestions for what ifs that you want me to even dabble in within the future. So if you like this kind of content, give me a like, give me a subscribe, all that love and stuff. And of course, with that being said, you guys, of course, have this fine day, been handsome. And as always, people, peace out.